Now, before we do anything, we need to define what we mean by revelation. And this has become very apparent from some of the things that Shabit has just been saying. What do we mean by revelation as Christians? And what do Muslims mean by revelation? Because what we're going to find out is that we have a different definition of revelation than what Islam has. And some of you, many of you probably can already see that from what Shabit has just gone through. Basically, when we're talking about revelation, when we're talking about God revealing himself as Christians, there's really four forms of revelation that we use. The first is what we know as general revelation. When we look out at nature and we see the sophistication that's in nature, we see the complexity in the trees and the flowers and the seasons and things like this, we can see that there has to be a designer behind the design. Now, Muslims and Christians agree on this. No problem here. I think we both agree that the God expresses himself in nature. But God doesn't stop there. God also wants to make sure that we hear and understand what he's talking about. So he sends emissaries. He sends prophets. He sends, as the Muslims know it, Rasuls, or he sends the many prophets that we see in the Old Testament. These are intermediaries between God and man. And for a Muslim, this is very essential, because in Islam, God does not come down and communicate to man face to face. But see, as in Christianity, we don't have that problem. We don't have that problem, because from the very beginning, if you go back to Genesis chapter 3, you can see right there in verses 8 and 9 of Genesis 3, there is God walking and talking with Adam and Eve in the garden. Something Islam does not accept, does not have in their own story, though they have that story, those two verses do not exist. So for that reason, they do not understand God can actually relate and come and talk to his created.
The point I'd like to respond to is Joseph Smith's point about the book of Genesis, that the Quran does not speak about God coming down and walking in the garden and talking to human beings. But actually, I see this as a positive thing about the Quran, not something negative. In fact, there are many such examples of where in the Bible you find a description of God that makes him look like a superhuman being. In the Quran, that description is absent, and in fact, sometimes even corrected, so that in the Quran we have a different understanding of God. An example of this is in Exodus chapter 31 in verse 17. There the Bible says that after God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, on the seventh day he rested and he was refreshed, to use the words of the King James Version of the Bible. And when I ask people, what do you mean by refreshed? They say, well, rested means this. I said, no, I'm not asking about the rested. What do you mean by refreshed? And there's no answer for that. But the Quran tells us that God didn't even rest. In the Quran, in Surah 50, ayah number 38, it says that God created the heavens and the earth and what is between them in 6 days, and nothing of weariness even touched him. According to Muslim understanding, God does not become tired. So I see it as a positive improvement. And this shows why the Quran, at the one time, agrees with the Bible, and at the same time, corrects it. The Quran says that it came to confirm what was revealed before it, and also to be a protector over the scripture from God, to show what really is a revelation and what cannot be a revelation from God. So the Quran corrects our image and view of God.